Om madhuro sharalo vakkaihi ishatattam prakashya krusha gato parisheshopi isha putro amritoya tamati shayang pavitram merijang lokabandhum parma prema murtim dinanatham bhajama Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. We bow down to Jesus Christ, whose sweet and simple message revealed the truth of the Divine, who, though crucified, is eternal and immortal, the Son of God, who is purity incarnate, born of Mary, the friend of all, the Lord of the lowly, and supreme love personified. Om peace, peace, peace be unto us all. So today, our topic is when love becomes personified. We think, we know, we have heard that God is love, and God is ever blissful. But how to understand that? We, the ordinary people who live in this world and always craving for little love and affection, and most of the time we are failing to receive that. We give our heart and soul and our life and everything, but at the end we find, I didn't get what I wanted. No. So how can I understand then that infinite love, which is God, how to feel that God is there? That's why it becomes the responsibility of the Lord, who have created this universe, to occasionally gives a glimpse of that love, which is called unconditional love, which is only giving and giving and giving, never asking for anything in return. That's a very pure love, that is the love which is cherished by all the seekers of truth. And all human kind, human being is seeking for that joy, which will be unfailing joy. But when it becomes personified, that becomes a wonderful expression of the Divine. We know what is God. We know how God is to the framework of our little mind and our little perception in which we live, in our this body and mind. So this is a grand opportunity for us to behold the very divine forms when they come down. That is the love and love and love. That's why this month, actually, we celebrate 2 days. One is Holy Mother's birthday, another also Christ. So both, we don't make any gender distinction here. But we know that the same divine absolute bliss appeared in this earth to give a touch of our understanding about what is called divine love, what is called God. Holy Mother, when she came down, we have read, we have heard again and again her life, we have discussed. Her love knows no limit, knows no boundary. Who is the recipient? There is no judgment about that. There is no consideration that he is higher, so I should have to give little more love. And he does not care so much. Okay, she is ordinary, so he can ignore. In the divine play of love, it does not happen. And we find this similar in the eye of the Lord who appeared in the form of Christ. It is unconditional giving, never thinking of himself, him the person, the form we see, the trouble, the tribulations, the suffering, what they go through is immeasurable, unbelievable, both in the life of all these great incarnations, we find that unique manifestation of love, unconditional. Unconditional love is a very difficult subject. Unconditional love, because we know only conditioned love. Even what is called the most pure love, there is also little expectation. You know, mother loves the baby. Baby does not do anything. But mother expects baby should smile. Occasionally be little charming. Some expectation is there. But can there be something? But there is no expectation. Only one-sided flow coming from the divine to us and touching and finished. He never looks back. What is in return, whom you gave, and whether he is right or wrong, capable or incapable, fit or unfit, no such consideration. So this is the unique phenomena in the spiritual realm. That's why I call avatar philosophy. When God comes down, that is a huge, what you call, an unique incident in the how that infinite becomes finite. It cannot be fathomed, it cannot be understood. Infinite becoming finite, who has no form becomes and takes a human form, who is beyond all qualities, takes the qualities as we are, all the weaknesses as we suffer, but taking in the body, those problems are there to face, but they always stand above all the circumstances. These are inspiration. That is the purpose. When this unique incident happens, that love becomes personified, that becomes in the whole world, it's a new inspiration starts from there. How to live in the life and how to transcend the limitations and our failures and all our weaknesses. Being and facing all the challenges, how one can keep the spirit so high and not even in that condition judging anyone. So, our time being short, we cannot go to both Holy Mother and to Christ, but rather I'll focus on Christ. Swami Vivekananda spoke once in Los Angeles in 1900, and what he said? He said, great predominance in the march of events, the liberal ideas are marshaled ahead to sink down, to digest, as it were, to ruminate over the past, to adjust, to conserve, to gather strength once more for the rise of a bigger rise. Wave rises in the ocean, and there is a hollow driving onward. Great souls, the messengers, they come at a period of history, of his race, may be well designated as great fall. And then he continues, this is Christ came, all the incarnations, all the holy people, they come when there is a downfall. Gita suggests that whenever there is a uprise of unrighteousness, and righteousness is forgotten, God incarnates. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata. O Bharata, O Arjuna, whenever there is a decline in the righteousness and social and moral degradation, therefore I make me appear again and again. It is not one time, it is a continuous process. Because people forget. After all the dedication, all the spiritual inspiration, what the people of that particular time may feel, may not feel. It takes time, hundreds of years it takes to reach the heart of the people. By that time they gain, and again degradation comes. So therefore, this is the downfall when it happens. The great souls, the messengers, come at that period of history, of his race, may well designate as a great fall. That is the time. And then he talked about Christ, the 3 years of his ministry were like one compressed and concentrated age, which it has taken 1900 years to unfold, and who knows how much longer it will take. The impact, the implication, the purpose of their advent, to understand that it takes long time, because we are not ready for that message. So too, it takes long time. Swamiji says that now 2000 years have passed, no? The impact of the advent of Christ is still continuing. But how many of us can understand what Christ stands for? What he came to give us? What we are imbibing from his life? It's not the rituals, it's not going to the church or chanting some verses or singing some beautiful carols. Good. That should inspire us. But how to apply it in life? And that is the purpose of their advent. Srimad Swamiji continues, Vivekananda continues, but mark this giant that came. Mark this giant that came centuries and ages past. Yet the energy that he left upon the world is not yet stressed. It goes on adding new vigor as the ages roll on. So this is the time. It goes on and its impact continues. Take one of these great messengers of light. Compare his character with the highest ideal of God that you have ever formed. And you will find that your God falls short of the ideal, and that the character of the prophet exceeds your conception. Beautiful idea. You have some concept about God. But when God incarnates in this way, you can see that, is it possible? Such dedication, such sacrifice, such total surrender to the human needs, forgetting about their basic minimum things of life even. So this is to be understood, that it is our conception about God is there. God is love, God is blessings, God is a protecting force. But when we see these unique characters, it excels even our imagination. That's why Swami Vivekananda forces this idea that these great messengers of light compare his character with the highest ideal of God as we have in our mind, that you have ever formed in our mind, in our imagination. And you will find that your God, that imagination of God, falls short of the ideal, and that character of the prophet exceeds your conception. Because Swami Vivekananda is talking about another form of Christ in the form of Ramakrishna. He saw when God comes down what happens, and how he's suffering in tremendous cancer, and seeing day and night that pain of suffering, but still continuously giving illumination, experience, redemption from all the bondage of life. Swami Vivekananda saw as a young boy, Naren, being in front of another Christ. There he saw that what agony, what pain, but what sacrifice, unconditional sacrifice. He is asking before his death, if you please give permission, then I can give up this body. I cannot. This body is too much going on to this suffering. But if you people permit, least they will feel, their inner circle will feel some sadness. That's why he's begging permission. So if you permit, then I can leave this body. Look at that life we are discussing about Christ. What type of pain and suffering has to go? But what a blessings. Oh Lord, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. Blessings for all. And what he get? What he gained from us? Only abuse. Even that is the fate of all the incarnations, all the messengers of the Lord. When they come, during their lifetime, they go through all this. But they are the conduit, or they are the power behind, the expressed power. But that is called the divine absolute Brahman. We have no concept. But when it comes down, it is like step-down transformer. The energy which is flowing in that high voltage comes down and becomes useful for us. We cannot handle 1000 volt current in our home. But that's why he has to squeeze himself. It's a pain for that person, no? Who has that tremendous power, he has to squeeze and take his human form and appear like a sweet and loving person to individual at the cost of their sacrifice. So this is the life of these great messengers. That's why he wanted that it should be perfect, as I am perfect. So you see that beautiful verse in the Bible you find. Christ says, his expectation is too high. He says, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. What a call for becoming perfect. We are so full of sins. We always call, I am a sinner, sinner, sinner. I did something wrong. What will happen to me? Oh, I am gone. Where is that? This messenger is saying, be ye perfect, as your Father in the heaven is perfect. And he exemplified there how perfect. And Swami Vivekananda also said that if I am to talk about Christ, I will say, if I, as an Oriental, had to worship Jesus of Nazareth, there is only one way left to me, that is to worship him as God and nothing else. That's why his love, as we are talking about, Christ says, come unto me all ye that are suffering and I shall give you rest. What a call. That he is with our stretched arm is calling everyone. There is no rejection of anyone. And what is the call for? That you are suffering and I shall give you rest. So this is the love. Love flows in unidirection. Ramakrishna used to cry after his own experience of God realization. He used to cry on the roof of the music tower, or even go to the, that's called the music tower. So he used to say, oh ye, come, come, I cannot bear anymore the separation from you. I want to, she's calling, 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 Krishna, playing the flute. At the midnight, when we sleep. But who are awake and they can respond to the call. They can feel the love. So it is, the Holy Mother said, again and again, I come, how much suffering, but I cannot help but to come. Sri Ramakrishna said that king sometimes visits the land incognito. John, the voice one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight. So the cry on both sides, but we are talking about the cry from the Lord Himself. Now, the light what came from Christ. What is the light came? If we think that this very common discussion we do normally to understand the gift of Christ. It is the same Vedantic message, what is mentioned in the Vedas, talking about his message to think in a form with a dualistic way, qualified non-dualism and the absolute oneness. Swami Vivekananda said, the light of Christ, what is the light of Christ? He says, to the masses who could not conceive anything higher than personal God, he said, pray to your Father in heaven. The others who could grasp a higher idea, he said, I am the vine and ye are the branches. But to his disciple, to whom he revealed himself more fully, he proclaimed the highest truth, I and my Father are one. See, the ancient message, people make a distinction, Hinduism, Christianity, Islam and Buddhism, this, that, because you want to roam in the periphery, never wanting to get inside. What is the message? This message what is given in the Upanishads, which has been taught again and again. In the lives of the great saints of the world, we find the same, Swami Vivekananda pointed out, the entire essence of Christ and Christ's teachings in the three phases. So we first said to the masses, for the general masses, as we are, body-bound people, what we think, I am in suffering, I am in pain, oh Lord, please help me. So that's why he conceived anything, then personal God, and Hinduism, there are many aspects of God is worshipped. But any aspect you can take, this is God in personal aspect. And he said, pray unto your Father in the heaven. We call the all the devotional practices we do, all the singing, chanting, praise we do, this falls in this category, separating myself, totally different, and God is somewhere there. So please pray, because I am so ignorant about myself, and I am ignorant about the divine, so spiritual struggle starts there, and that is the instruction. Now, those who have raised their consciousness a little higher, Swami Vivekananda says to others, who could grasp a higher idea, little higher idea. And he said, that you see, I am not too much, totally separate. Not that I am separate and he is separate, two identities. But I am the same. He is the whole, I am the part. So, Lord is the fire. And I am only a spark. God is only the infinite ocean. I am only a little wave. So I am not totally separate and not totally one. And now comes but to the disciples who are special people. That's why always when God comes, he brings his own people around them. Otherwise, who will understand them? And we will mistake and misunderstand and mistreat. That we do always. But there are some people should be there to understand. Ramakrishna came, with him came Vivekananda, Brahmananda, Shivananda, these people. Who could understand what Sri Ramakrishna is talking? Even Vivekananda is saying that you don't understand Sri Ramakrishna. When he was asked to write about Ramakrishna, he's such a prolific writer, speaker, everything. He said, shall I make a doll of monkey? While preparing a Shiva image. I am unfit, he's talking about. But these people can understand the best. So to them he revealed the Sri Ramakrishna is talking to Naren. Why do you feel, he's asking, come and sit here. And he's out of shyness and senior and spiritual people, you don't sit in the same level always. So he said, why are you making a separation from me? Am I separate from you? So this is the message of the highest category of people, but the disciple said, to whom he revealed himself, and they revealed the glory of him, the Lord himself, more fully, and he proclaimed the highest truth, that I and my Father are one. So this is the three stages of realization. That is the message what Christ gave it to us. If we go to the Gnostic Gospel, it says that hidden saying of the Savior spoken to Judas, Thomas, which Matthias in turn recorded it. He said, the Savior said, "Brother Thomas, while you are still in wilderness, listen to me, and I shall reveal to you what you have thought about in your heart. Since it is said that you are my twin brother, examine yourself and understand who you are and how you will come to be." You know, in the Gita we find, it's a beautiful idea. In the Gita, Krishna and Arjuna talking. There, "You are my friend." So here also we find, Christ says, "Since it is said that you are my twin brother, and examine yourself and understand who you are and how you will come to be. Since you are to be called my brother, it is not fitting for you to be ignorant about yourselves." See, Vedantic highest knowledge is being given, know thyself. Who are you? You are not a mixed, only physical entity, flesh and bone. You are who you are. Try to know that, because you want to be like me, is a friend of me, so you should have that uplifting mood to understand your own divine self. "I know that you have already understood that I am the knowledge of the truth." See, beautiful word. You know, you can understand, as I, means the Christ, is already, and the knowledge of the truth. I am that. You have understood I, the same reality came down out of love for humanity. You understood that. I am that Satchidananda in Vedantic language, I'll say. Of course, it's my explanation. may not be accepted by all. But this is the idea that I, Christ says, "I know that you have already understood that I am the knowledge of the truth." That is the, it is called the Vedanta called Tattvam. You are. I am that. You are that. Aham Brahmasmi. I am that. What you are also that. So go beyond the body and mind and all this perception. But you are that. Try to understand that. See that the Gnostic Gospel, which is normally obscured from our normal reading, but we find those references there. Exactly Vedanta, actually really so fantastic to see the similarity there. "I know that you have already understood that I am the knowledge of the truth. So, while you are walking with me, though you lack understanding, you have obtained the knowledge." It's also another idea. That as you are walking with me, though you have not perfectly understood it, but you can understand it, that you have obtained the knowledge. Know that you have obtained. "For those who have not known themselves," who is saying this? "For those who have not known themselves have known nothing." You want to get the message of Christ? Here is the Christ message. Unless you know yourself, you have known nothing. So we know ourselves. What do we know? As if all the time we are in Vedanta talking. We know I am a body-mind complex. I am this, penis. I am my emotions. I am my failures. I am my success. I am rich. I am poor. Whatever. I, this. But what he says? For those who have not known themselves have known nothing. But those who have known themselves already have acquired knowledge about the depth of the universe. You see, Upanishad says, "Eko jnane sarva jnano." You know one, then you know everything. You know one gold, then you know all gold ornaments. All the knowledge. That is knowing that one, you know everything. "So, then my brother Thomas, you have seen what is hidden from people, what they stumble against in their ignorance." You know how the world, we all ordinary people, are stumbling in ignorance. This Vedantic term, we are in ignorance. We don't see who are we. We do not know who is God. So the Trinity, God, creation and me. That is the relationship. What is this relationship? These are three different identities. But it is not three, it is only one. That's why Christ says, so then my brother Thomas, you have seen what is hidden from people. You have seen being with me. You have raised with my Ramakrishna's presence, you know, consciousness of Naren, Brahmananda, Shivananda, their mind is to get uplifted. They could feel that they are feeling the oneness. Ramakrishna touched Naren and his whole universe is saturated with one consciousness. That's all. Ocean of bliss and nothing else. And he cried out, what are you doing for me? I am my mother, I am my father. Meaning, again coming back to the body consciousness, he is crying out, no, it is too much for me. But ultimately he was established in that truth. So he says that you, being with me, you have understood yourself, you have understood a glimpse of what I am. But those people, those from whose the eyes, this knowledge is hidden, and they stumble against in their ignorance. So as a result, they stumble into ignorance, as we are all stumbling into our ignorance and get lost there. Therefore Upanishad says, Atmanam tu bijaniyat. You know your Atman, you know yourself. If you don't know and you know everything of the world, you are spoiling your time and energy in wrong direction. At the point of death you will find, what I gain, what shall I carry with me, but knowing our real nature. So that is the inspiration here. If what is visible to you is obscured to you, how can you comprehend things of exalted majesty and fullness which are invisible? So if our vision is so much covered in this ignorance, that even in visible universe where the consciousness is palpably present, we have no eye to see that, how can you go in a deeper depth and to feel that oneness? Therefore, whatever is subject to change, we are reading Vedanta, whatever is subject to change will perish and be lost, and henceforth has no hope of life, because this body is an animal body. Just as an animal body perishes, this model forms also will perish. So you are children until you become perfect. So it is the conclusion, why we should be perfect. If it is not, it is lost. Just like so many creatures are born, they leave, and the Kathopanishad says, that it is like a Upanishad, Kathopanishad says, Shasyam iva marta jayate pachyate punaha. Like that, grains and trees and plants and animals, they come, grow and die one day. This is the purpose of life. Here is the call, that understand everything here is subject to change. And whatever is subject to change will perish and be lost, because it is change. And henceforth, there is no hope of life, because this body is an animal body, because it will also perish. And therefore, just as an animal body perishes, those modeled forms, all the modeled forms in the world will perish. So, therefore, the conclusion is this. So, you are children of God until you become perfect. So Vedanta says, Tatramasi, thou art that. Realize that you are not this body and mind, but you are the divine. Gnostic gospel reveals these ideas. Thomas answered, when light comes and banishes darkness, then the accomplishments of each will be clear. And your light bring enlightenment, O Master. When light comes, banishes darkness. As you know, Vedanta says, you bring the light of consciousness, the darkness and ignorance will vanish. The accomplishments of each will be clear. Then our purpose, our life's purpose has been achieved. You have seen the light. What is the real nature of us? Jesus said, it is through light that light exists. It is through light the light exists. This light exists. Through that light you see that. That's Upanishad said. We say jyoti ra jyoti in the prayer. It's called he shining, everything shines. He's the light of the light. Through which this earthly light. Blessed Thomas, surely this visible light has shone for you, not to keep you here, but that you might leave. And when the chosen ones lay down their animal nature, this light will withdraw up to its being, and its being will welcome to itself, because the light is a good helper. It's a beautiful mystic words, no? It needs deep contemplation. He says, blessed Thomas, surely this visible light has shone for you. Why? Not to keep you here. Your mind should move on. What is this light? Who is the light behind? It is just taking you from this apparent expressed light in the physical plane to take you into the eternal light. But so that you might leave this apparent expressions of this universe or the light, etc. And when the chosen ones lay down their animal nature, we are all chosen in that sense. God is calling us. So we are chosen. But it is our business whether to respond or not to do. So therefore God is giving this permission also. Yeah? But among the chosen people who lay down their animal nature, now ready to get out of the animal nature. Animal nature means sleeping, eating, drinking and dying. This is called animal nature. Those animals do that. They have no other option. They are programmed like that. Their whole lifestyle is programmed like that. Don't you hear that someone in another life, animal life, can think of the absolute Brahman? Of course, maybe, I do not know, but mostly not, because we human body, in getting this human body with this human intellect, super mind, super quality of mind, we cannot think of the absolute, infinite, and how it is possible for a animal body which is limited by its senses, in my mental unfoldment is not that as we have blessed by God. So it is blessed. So it is when the chosen ones, we have the courage and strength to lay down their animal nature, what will happen? This light will withdraw up to its being. This light, you look at this light, you look at the sun, and seeing the sun, you will be drawn into the sun, who is the light behind the sun. Wherever there is any manifestation, you look and just behold, and you will behold something beyond that apparent expression of light or expression of reality. And its being will welcome, and its being, that being, will welcome to itself, because the light is good helper. This light takes you to the eternal light, so it will help you. So light to light, move light to light. Only one responsibility, to give up the animal instinct, to go into our divine self, that is the. So what a parallel principle which Vedanta teaches us. We always hear that. The Savior continues, that is why it is said that everyone who seeks truth from true wisdom wings to fly, fleeing from the passion that burns human spirits. And one will fashion wings to flee from every visible spirit. Very profound statements. That is why it is said that everyone who seeks truth from true wisdom, with this wisdom, that reality present here, with that is the wings, and that wing will fly up and fleeing from the, what to fly away from? Fly away from, as he has mentioned, the animal nature to the divine nature. So he says, fleeing from the passion that burns human spirit. Where is joy? We like all these sensate objects, but it does not ultimately satisfy us. So therefore, it burns the human spirit. The very strong words of Vedanta. That's why this part has been totally taken off from the public. And one will fashion wings. Yeah, he will create another wing, as it were, fashion wings to flee from every visible spirit. This visible universe, they will be flying, their mind will be soaring high and high and high, and fly in that realm of absolute joy. If you want to be perfect, keep these sayings. If you want to be perfect, keep these sayings. That means you have to transcend. It is your call. Opportunity is given. The light is here. Through this light you can see the light behind. And every flower when it blooms, everything which is attracting to our eyes, who is shining, who is attracting us? That's the light of that, it's the love of that, it is Satchidananda that, in Vedantic term, but here also the same language, you will fly into that reality, that this light will lead you to that absolute reality. The intelligent person is perfect in all wisdom, but to the fool, good and evil are the same. It's a very common expression. To the fool, those who have not developed this fineness of their mental mind and purity of the mind, for them good and bad has no meaning. They can cheat, they can blame, they can do all types of things, at the same time think it is okay to support that. But it is you want to be perfect, then intelligent person, you will be intelligent person, and the perfect in all wisdom, they will have to do this. Give up this lower nature and fly into the infinite nature of our being, and that to the path of light and light. For fools, the fire that guides them gives them an illusion of truth. It will shine on them with a perishable beauty, and it will imprison them in dark delight and capture them in sweet smelling pleasure. And it will make them blind with the insatiable desire, inflame their souls, and be like a stake that is jammed into their heart and can never be removed. Vedanta does not say so strongly, but what Christ is saying is too much. But truth is truth. Truth is truth. If you want to have that type of ecstatic joy, so these are all true. But the fools, he is talking to the fools. For fools, the fire that guides them, they guide, we are all drawn to the attractive things of the world. And what he says, gives them an illusion of truth. This is the same thing. It is not the truth. But it gives the reality and probability of the truth here, and that's why we are all rushing towards all the five senses and whatever the objects of the senses to find our joy and satisfaction and peace. But you want absolute pure life or life of illumination? Then he says, but this illusion, what it will do? It will shine on them with a perishable beauty. Okay, you hold on to that and you find after a few years it is not the same. It has changed. And your impression changes. But again, our weak point, I hold on to another something, holding that it will be permanent. And then also, that also perishes after some time. So, perishable beauty, and it will imprison them because of running towards that. It will imprison them in dark delight. There is a delight, but the delight of darkness and ignorance. And capture them in the sweet smelling pleasure, sweet smelling pleasure. And it will make them blind with insatiable desire. The desire, as the scriptures always suggest, no? You desire, fulfilling the desire, you cannot end it. It will bring more desire and more desire and more desire. And going to the fulfill that desire as much as we move, Jayati, there is a story of the king. He was a king, Jayati, king of India. So he enjoyed his whole life in the sensate world as a kingly pleasure and kingly enjoyment. And then, but he became old. Then he thought that, had I got another youthful life? But how it will be possible? So he went to a sage. The sage suggested, okay, you will be a young man. If some young person exchanges your old age, then it is possible. Okay, then his son, he sacrificed. Okay, my father wants this, I sacrifice my youth. So he became young, the king Jayati became young, and he took the responsibility of becoming old. And after enjoying another life, full-fledged life of a king, the Jayati said, Najatu kaman kamu upabhogena sammati. Your satiation, your satisfaction will never come by only putting butter, clarified butter, milk, ghee in a flame. You think that I put little ghee. Okay, it will put a little fire, it will cool down. No, it will flame, in flame. Then give another. That is his experience. He said, no, yatu kaman. By these expectations and desires cannot be fulfilled by supplying all these ingredients again and again and again. Kaman, najatu kaman, kamu upabhogena sammati, hovisha krishna bartmaivo, bhuyoyevo. It will increase and enhance in the heart. The desire goes on and on. So this same idea, inflame their souls and be like a stick. And that is actually they got stuck there for quite a while. Then, blessing on the wise, perfect person who has sought truth when it has been found, has rested upon it forever, and has not been afraid of those who wish to trouble him. So, this is he has described two conditions. One condition of an ignorant person, another condition of the wise person who have taken to fly following the path of light and light and light, go to that self and know what is this person as not the body-mind, but something, the spirit. Then their blessings on the wise person who has sought this truth, when it has been found, has rested upon it forever. So their peace rests forever, has not to be afraid of this in this world, whatever happens, who is to trouble him. So that is the point. That's why here it is said, Swami Vivekananda says perfectly, matching with this lesson, he said, he that loseth, what did Christ say? Swami Vivekananda quotes, he that loseth his life for my sake, shall find it. You have to lose your life. You have to lose your ego. You have to lose your petty identity. You have to lose all the things in the world. That's why it says, he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. So Swami Vivekananda says, what did Christ say? Quote, he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. Again and again did he preach renunciation as the only way to perfection. That is the profound idea what Christ gave to us. And of course, it is not only that message, but he also gave us wonderful ideal which we can, if it is too high, we can take other courses also. So only inspiration to take us out of our ignorance, to make us free. And that is called hell. Hell means what? Hell is not a place when really there is somebody pouring hot, boiled fire on my body. But it is the mental condition will be such that you will feel miserable. You are not understanding the hidden joy in oneself. That's why they say to be perfect. How to be perfect? Following them as your Father in the heaven is perfect. Lay not up to yourself treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But we collect all these things, all our bank balance or whatever we do, don't mind, you will have to have bank balance. But the point is what Christ is saying, that let it be. But I should not be totally bound in a blame and a bound slave of them. That is the Vedanta says. You live in the world, have everything, but try to detach. Otherwise, they are holding on. So, what he says, lay not up for yourself treasures upon earth. Your whole life you earn money and keep it in the bank, and the moment I die, whose money is that? So, that's why, where moth and rust doth corrupt. In this world, everything is changeable, everything is moving, and everything is unstable. Where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steals. So, what is the idea? We can think in this way. So many ideas we can take. But we can take at this idea is very wonderful. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these will be added unto you." So that is the point, what to seek. In this world of duality, we live in this duality, nothing wrong, but only to understand what to crave for. What should be our focus and how should we live an intelligent life? Intelligent life so that we live in this life and make profit out of this life. This is a unique opportunity given by God to us. How to profit out of this body, mind and the intelligence and the opportunities given to us so that we can stay in our own divine self. So, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Ramakrishna said the same word, no? Seek ye first the kingdom of God. What Ramakrishna said? By any means, just realize God. And then you do whatever you like. Is it? It's the same thing, no? First ye seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these will be added unto you. If you get that, sab chhodke sab paave. Swami Vivekananda used to say this word, sab chhodke. If you can give up everything, then you get everything. It's a very contradictory term. You give up everything and you get everything. I think that they look at the wandering monks of India. Sab chhodke, Buddha. Look at Buddha. It is not totally just an imagination. See, look at Buddha. Buddha gave up his whole kingdom, his all the pleasurable things, all wealth, prosperity, name, fame. He's the king of the world, prince of the world, of the such big continent. But sab chhodke, and then he became Buddha. Who would have remembered the king Buddha? How many kings came and ruled in different continents? But Buddha is remembered for whom? How many years? 2500 years gone. Its impact is not less. It is becoming more. Everyone knows Buddhism, is it not? All over the world. So, chop chorke, sab paave. You get everything if you give up everything. It is true. Otherwise, how in Buddha's life it happened? Look at Christ. He didn't go for world and worldliness, but he lived for God and God. And what happened? 2,000 more years he is ruling over the world. People like this church or that church or like, dislike, that's not the point. But Christ in the heart of all. Whole of India worships Christ more than Christian world worships. In our balloon mart, in our all the centers, Christmas is considered in such a holy celebration with so much love and affection. Christ is in the heart. Forget about your philosophy, what you make and what church says, what we say, what we and forget that. Christ himself. So his example, sab chhodke, sab paave. Give up everything for God and you got everything. What more you expect? Thousands of years, still he is remembered. We try to remember ourselves, my name. So if someone gives some donation, they say, in India, I don't know whether it happens. And here also, foundation is made in the name of my father, my son, my name. In India, you will find much that even he gives, my name should be on the wall of the temple that I have donated this money. Huh? What's the call there? Call is that I will be remembered. Every one of us wants to be remembered. But what's the way of remembering? Who will remember? 7 billion people now, or more than six billion. Who will remember whom? We only at the memorial service we say, ha ha, hoo-hoo, you are so great, aha, we miss you. but look at that. After some days, those who said ha ha hoo, they also forget. So this is the way. But we are bewildered, as Christ said, taught us in his own language, that we are thinking in our own way that the world is such. But world, who is there? They are perfect. All the sages. Naal pishukam asti bhumaiva sukam. As you match Upanishad and Christ and all these things, you can match. If the right perspective, you will find that their message is the same message. According fitted to the context of the time, it was little different, but it is the call. You are to renounce for God. You are to give up for God. You are doing that. You are sitting here 1 hour for one reason. You have so many duties. You are renouncing your time, 1 hour time, and not 1 hour time, coming and going back. All these added together so much. Why? You are giving something, you are getting something, with the hope. And when we struggle in our inner spirit, then we really get that which is unavailable in anywhere in the world. Thank you, Jayama. So you should not go back with this idea that we'll have to give up everything of your home and hearth. Not that. It is meaning that let them be, but let it be belong to God. And not me, the owner. Even the body is not me. I'm not the owner, the Lord's machine. So that spirit is to be taken, otherwise it will be total wrong meaning of 1 hour talking that you give up everything and go to the forest. No, that is not the point. Point is that let there be everything, but everything belongs to the Lord. And I also belong to the Lord. So that is to be the proper spirit of giving up everything, you receive everything. The identity is the question. Okay, now I conclude with this prayer. Om Krishtayo Isho Dutayo Isho Dharma Pracharine Atmo Tyag Pradiptayo Sannashine Vai Namaha Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. I salute and worship Lord Jesus Christ, the messenger of the Lord, who came to preach the message of the Lord, who is an embodiment of, who is burning beauty of renunciation and self-renunciation and every renunciation's ideal of renunciation. To that adorable monk I salute again and again. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto us all.